2028 का, तो दे आर गोइंग टू सॉल्व फ्यू क्वेश्चन अबाउट देम। ओके, तो बिफोर गोइंग टू द मेन पार्ट ऑफ द वीडियो, आई वांट टू रिक्वेस्ट यू दैट इफ यू आर न्यू ऑन दिस चैनल एंड यू आर वाचिंग दिस वीडियो, देन प्लीज सब्सक्राइब द चैनल एंड हिट द बेल आइकन सो दैट यू कैन गेट रेगुलर अपडेट्स रिगार्डिंग माय वीडियो, एंड इट विल रियली हेल्पफुल फॉर यू for preparing using this program. So there is a subscribe button and bell icon right there. So in detail, I also prepare for the third round of UPSC 2016. So it's very difficult for me to make regular videos related to the topic. But despite of that, I try to make with more videos on this topic, which are going to really going to help you with this technology, is going to help you on the test of that. So let's go to the main part of the video. This video we are, as I earlier said, we are going to solve a few UCS questions which have already come in the 20 years. So let's start with the first question. This question is that which one of the following systems is an example of the at least three fundamental forces? So, can you all remember the electromagnetic force? For the sphere of neutron, we have only one force, and the gravitational force that we want to consider. Also, the gravitational force is very negligible at the particle level because relative masses are very, very small. So, we can neglect the gravitational force. The pair of neutrons can be considered as three types of forces because due to the unavailability of the charge over the neutron particles, also do not show the electromagnetic force. Attraction between them or repulsion. So, second option we have pair of electrons here. The pair of protons, we have some force because protons are available in the nucleus of the atom, and another is the electromagnetic force is available on the due to the positive charge of the proton, and another is the weak force because when there is decay, proton is decay to the neutron not in the free medium but in the atom. For the proton, we have three forces. The correct option is really proton. So we have strong force. We clearly neglect the relative difference in the masses are very, very large. Masses of particles are very, very small relative to us. Gravity force is very, very negligible at the particle level. So, correct option is C. For D option, we also do not have the electromagnetic force again because due to the availability of charge on the neutron. So, correct option is C. We have pair of protons. We have three fundamental forces at least. Another question is which of the following quantities are conserved in the weak interaction? So for every interaction, we know the charge must be conserved, electron number must be conserved, baryon number must be conserved. So options 1 to 3 at least conserve in every interaction process to process a reaction. And whatever the interaction is, they don't matter, but at least 3 is three quantities like charge, electron number, baryon number in every interaction. So But the strangeness is your quantum number is only concerned with the strong interaction kind of reaction. So for we are talking about the weak interaction, so option B is correct. Charge electron number and gradient number are conserved for the weak interaction forces. Another one is the alpha decay and beta decay are. So as I earlier said, the beta decay is generally occurred due to the weak force. Alpha decay is process which occurred due to the relative combined effect of electron force and the electromagnetic force. So the correct option for A is for A, electron force and weak force respectively. Another option because the alpha decay do not occur due to single electromagnetic force and the beta decay is also not occur due to the strong force. So more appropriate or more accurate to perfect answer for this question is option A, strong force, alpha decay for the strong force and beta decay for the weak force. So now we move on to next question. Next question is we have to find the diagonal derivative corresponding to SF space. We have the function FX XYZ and the surface equation is given, which is 2x square plus 3xy. 3x square, 3y square plus z square. So we have to find the directional derivative in the direction of A. So the definition of the directional derivative is that we have to find first normal to the surface and for a particular point. A point is given here, point P, point coordinates are given x equal to 2 and y equal to 1 and z equal to 3. So here we have to find the direction derivative in the direction of A, which is the vector A is given here. Vector A is equal to I minus 2k cap. So the direction derivative is generally defined as a dot product of the surface normal with the unit vector in which direction we are going to calculate. So we can calculate the direction derivative here using the relation del gradient. The gradient of F which will give us to the normal to the surface. And we have to find it at a point P. So we calculate the gradient of F at point P. First calculate the gradient and put the values of XYZ, the coordinates of P, and then multiply the product of it with the unit vector of A. The unit vector of A is J vector divided by magnitude of A. Magnitude of A, we can calculate magnitude of A is the root square of the multiplication factor in the direction. So by using this formula we can calculate the directional derivative, or you can easily calculate directional derivative with this formula, and so just apply this formula and you get the answer. Another one is we have to calculate the divergence of a vector, which is vector is given here. Divergence we have to again calculate. So divergence we can calculate, divergence of vector, suppose we have a vector, we can consider it as vector A, so divergence of A. So we know that the divergence vector is the first derivative and then the additive terms for the different axes. So we can calculate divergence of A. Divergence of A is equal to I multiplied by del x. So you can calculate from here what is the divergence of this. Now we move on to the next question. We have to find the matrix eigenvalues and eigenvectors. So here we have two ways to calculate matrix eigenvalue. First is we generally use the characteristic expression. We can use A minus lambda I equals to 0. this is the one way to calculate the eigenvalue corresponding to the Fibonacci series. But here we can also apply the tricks so that we can calculate the eigenvalues of the matrix in the relative short time. So what is the trick is here that we know that for any square matrix, the space of the matrix is equal to the summation of the different eigenvalues of the matrix. So given that A is equal to the matrix, so we have two eigenvalues, the lambda 1 plus lambda 2. Trace of A is equal to the sum of summation of the trigonal elements of the matrix. So we have 2. 1 plus 1 is equal to 2. Another is here the determinant of the matrix is equal to the product of the matrix. Product of the eigenvalues of the matrix. So lambda 1 is multiplied by lambda 2 is the determinant of matrix A. So we have determinant of matrix A is first multiply this term, then subtract multiplication. We have minus 3 multiplication. So from here you can calculate the energy eigenvalue. We can say that summation of energy eigenvalue is equal to 2. The summation of energy eigenvalue is equal to 2 in which option? We have two options for this, option C and D. But only for option C, we have summation of equal to minus 2, sorry, plus 2. For option D, we have summation equal to minus 2. So, but we do not have that equal to minus 2, so correct option is here is option C. Now we move on to the next question. Our next question is we have to find the orthogonal matrix. The condition for the this question, we apply the condition of the orthogonal matrix. The condition of the orthogonal matrix is the transpose of the matrix multiplied with matrix itself is equal to the matrix. So for a particular matrix, transpose of matrix, matrix multiplied with the matrix itself is the identity vector. It's sufficient condition for the orthogonal matrix. So by applying this condition, we can get the correct option regarding this for this question. And another, now we move on to the next question. Next question is which one of the following equations will remain the same while changing the medium? So while changing the medium, directly answer this question. The first question is the magnetic monopole does not exist in any kind of medium. So correct option is only option B. Second equation of Maxwell is always going to be same because magnetic monopole does not exist in any medium. And all the other equations are changing with the medium because of changing the style and value and the permittivity and as well as the permeability values. So these values are generally changed. But for option B, Maxwell's second equation, we do not have parameters in the equation. So it remains same for the whole kind of medium. So correct option is here. B. Actually, I do not solve this question completely. I'm just trying to put a way or how to approach the question. So, also remember that you have 120 questions and you have to solve it in the 120 minutes. So, you have to practice hard and practice more and more. So, you can attempt more questions in the exam. Now, we move on the next question. Next question is the speed of electron in the uniform electric field changes from 0.95 c to 0.98 c. C is the velocity of the light. The change in the mass of electron will be. Change in the mass of electron relative to when this speed changes from 0.95 to 0.98 c is the trick. So we know that from the Einstein's relation of the m is equal to m naught. M naught is the text mass of electron divided by the root 1 divided by 1 minus e square divided by c square. So this is the like relativity of mass, or when the velocity of particle approaches the c, then we use the relativity mass condition. So from this relation we can solve For both values, actually solve with the 0.953. We put the value of V equal to 0.953 in the relation and we get the relativity mass value. And then we calculate same for 0.983. But then we subtract to the two and then we get the final result. The change in the mass of the electron and the spin changes from 0.953 to 0.983. So using relativistic mass equation or whatever you call it, to use it and solve to get the final answer. Now we move on to the next question. The next question is to what will be the speed of proton whose kinetic energy is double to its rest mass energy. So to solve this question, first you actually know the total what is the total energy of the system, or well, how we can write the total energy of the system. The total energy of the system we can write equal to kinetic energy or the thermal energy. Kinetic energy, we can P equals the total energy, K represents the kinetic energy, P represents the potential energy. So T as you given the kinetic energy of double to the rest mass energy. So rest mass energy of the proton is equal to rest mass multiplied by the speed of proton. We generally use the velocity of light here. So potential energy is m not the rest mass of proton, and it's given that the kinetic energy doubles of the rest mass energy. So we use 2 m not c square. And the total energy of the system and its speed approaches to the c can be calculated or written in terms of the gamma, otherwise we can call it gamma. Just to put it in the terms of under root of 1 minus c square divided by c square. So we generally write it like root c square equals to 3 m c square gamma, and then we get the gamma equals to 3. Gamma equals 3, gamma always equals to 1 shown here. If you solve this equation, then we get if you solve this equation, then you got equal to 2√2 divided by 3 into t. Correct option for this is option A. Now next question is the probability of having at least two tails in four throws with this fair point. Fair point means you have one side is head and another side is tail. So in the fourth throw we have total 16 outputs related to the head and tail and different combination of head and tail. So we have to find the probability of at least two tails. So we can calculate it otherwise also. That we have at least we know that the total probability of 16 outcomes is equal to 1, so we can calculate in the reverse order. Like we calculate the probability of like no tail, and then we calculate the probability of one tail, and then we subtract it from the one, and then we get the answer. So the at least the probability of the getting at least two tails. So we get to calculate it two tails. One is the total probability of the system to get 16 outcome. One is to get the no tails. No tails is only the all outcomes are ahead. So only one probability out of 16. So we get here 1/16. And another one is the at least one tail. At least one tail, we have four outputs because at least one tail have this kind of form. So this kind of form has four different combinations. So according to we consider the four kind different kind of combinations to get the at least one tail, then and to get the probability of at least two tails, we have to subtract it from there. So total is 1 minus 1 minus 5 by 16, and then we get the output. Let's talk to you often. Now I delete the pure part so that you can show another different this here. Now we move on to the next question. Here given the characteristic polynomial delta t of the matrix A is T. We have to find out the characteristic polynomial of the matrix. So Kelly Hamilton theorem told us that for every square matrix, the characteristic equation or the eigenvalue equation also followed by the matrix itself. So to get the characteristic polynomial of matrix A, we have to first find out the eigenvalue equation or the polynomial equation in terms of the eigenvalue. Then we can calculate the characteristic polynomial corresponding to it. So we use the relation here, x minus lambda equals to 0. So we get if we put lambda over there, then we get the relation x minus lambda and 1 minus lambda here. So we multiply and we calculate determinant of it, then we get the lambda square lambda. So we will put it, rearrange it, and then we will put it. So this is the characteristic equation in terms of the energy eigen values. So Kelly Hamilton theorem tells us that the matrix itself also follows the characteristic equation of the energy eigenvalues. So we just put the we put the lambda t in place of the lambda. So if you put the t in place of lambda, then we get that option D is the characteristic polynomial corresponding to matrix A. That option is D for this question. Now we move on the next question. Next question, we have to find out the linear dependent the two vectors are given here, vector v and vector u. So we have to find out which option is correct. The first option is linear dependent or linear independent or linearly independent, and then u is subset of v and v is subset of u. We can see that none of the u and v are the subset of others. Because subset is defined is like the it's a subgroup of a large point group. So u and v are do not lie in the interval of each other. So option C and D are not correct. We have to find out option out of A and B. So to get the nature of the linear independent dependent nature of the vectors, we have to use a trick which is to multiply u vector u and v with some arbitrary constant, and then we solve for the arbitrary constant, and based on the arbitrary constant value we can get the what kind of nature the vector u and v has. So for this we multiply u with u, a1 with u, and this with u. This is the condition to check out the whether the vectors are linear dependent or independent. So we then process it again. Then we get two equations from here. We substitute a1 and a2. Another one is minus ratio to 0 will be again proceeded also we can rearrange it like a minus equal to definitely we can again write in terms of it we will get out three outside of equation and then we get the relation a1 minus a2 these are the relations of same right like the first equation is a1 minus a2 equal to 0 and we also a1 minus a2 equal to 0 these two are same exactly same question 2 we actually subtract one equation into 2 then it also satisfies that then total equation is we get 0 equal to 0 form so both equation a1 or a2 must be 0 so that's the solution is equal to 0 so the solution is linearly dependent and we can also see it like that mu equals mu is 1 minus 3 if you multiply the points of u that is inside by minus 2 then we get the same point which is so we get minus 2 and if you multiply the vectors u by minus 2 then we get the vector v so these are linearly dependent vectors just multiply by factor of minus 2 so the a is correct now we have to find for next question we have to find out the complementary solution of given differential equation so for complementary solution to get the complementary solution we assume that this differential equation has a solution of the common y to m exponential mx then we put it in this differential equation and we get the relation m square the solution of this equation if we solve out it further then we get m plus 3 plus 5 plus 0 root of this equation is m equals to 3 equals to minus 3 and plus 5 so that's the answer for this we put values in the y equals to mx exponential mx then we put term to and the so for this solution we have correct answer option D. Now next question is interpolation method is interpolation is a method to is like question one goes to that where is the interpolation method is generally used. So the first option is to solve differential equation initially. Now we can have to use interpolation to solve the differential equation. Another is to find root of polynomial interpolation methods are generally do not also use for the root of the polynomial the finding the roots of the polynomial we have different other like secant method is there Newton option is there few other methods also is there but we do not have interpolation for this interpolation is mainly used to find out the values of the points lying between the known points. So we have set of data points and if we want to calculate the point values of some considering between the data available then we use the interpolation kind of interpolation process. If we want to calculate the function values outside of data point then we use the extrapolation process. So here is asked for the interpolation so the correct option for this is option two. These are the 15 questions that I covered for which are already coming in the UPSC GCSE exam 2020 and I will be coming with few more videos to solve few more questions related to pure physics and the physics certainly like today in the late evening or in the tomorrow I will also upload any video related to the question solution which coming the 2020 assessed paper, like generally speaking paper, so to get an idea what kind of questions are generally asked from or and how it can solve this kind of questions easily. So to get more updates, please subscribe channel and enjoy your day.